and we'll now move on to the next item of business. But before I call the First Minister, I am aware that details of today's COVID-19 update have been reported in the media prior to being announced to the Parliament. I should not be reading in the media that they have seen a draft copy of the statement before it has been made to this Parliament. This is extremely disappointing and is disrespectful to this Parliament and its elected members. I have spoken to the Minister for Parliamentary Business about this, and he has informed me that the Government will be undertaking an inquiry into the leak. Now, I will allow the statement to be delivered today because I cannot be assured that all elected members have seen the full draft. And also, it's important that the public hear the full detail. But before I call the First Minister, I ask for an assurance from the First Minister of her commitment to the place of this Parliament being respected by her Government and her commitment to a repeat of this situation being avoided.
Second Officer, thank you. And let me, first of all, give you that assurance. Aside from disrespect to Parliament, which is a very serious matter, let me also assure you there is no benefit or advantage to the Scottish Government in the contents of these statements being known in advance of me delivering them to Parliament. I have asked my officials to look into this matter, and I can advise the Chamber that the Scottish Government's Chief Information Security Officer will be undertaking appropriate inquiries to establish if there has indeed been a leak of some of the contents of this statement in advance of me delivering it, and if so, what the circumstances and the source of that are. And I undertake to keep your office advised of the progress and outcome of that. But let me assure you, Presiding Officer, that I take very seriously my obligations and responsibilities and those of my Government to this Parliament, and I hope you will accept that assurance. Presiding Officer, today I will report on the current course of the pandemic. I will assess the latest data and set out our tentative view that although significant uncertainties do remain, both in the data and in the immediate period ahead, there are nevertheless some grounds for cautious optimism that a combination of the protective measures introduced before Christmas, the responsible action on the part of the general public, and the rapid delivery of booster vaccines have had a positive impact. As a result, I will indicate that from next week we will begin to lift the measures introduced before Christmas, but that we will do so in a phased and careful way, starting with the removal of attendance limits on live outdoor events from Monday. First, though, I will run through today's statistics. 10,392 positive cases were reported yesterday as a result of PCR tests, which is 27.7% of all PCR tests carried out. 1,479 people are in hospital with COVID, 47 more than yesterday. 65 people are in intensive care. 11 of them have been in intensive care for more than 28 days. And sadly, a further 16 deaths have been reported, taking the total number of deaths under the daily definition to 9,950. And again, I send my condolences to everyone mourning a loved one. The increased transmissibility of the Omicron variant is still causing very high levels of infection here in Scotland, across the UK, and in many cases around the world. However, while the situation, not least for the National Health Service, does remain very challenging, there are some very early indications in the data that offer some encouragement. Firstly, while it is always difficult to prove a direct causal link between any specific action or measure and subsequent outcomes, there is reason to be optimistic that protective measures, the behavioural response of the general public and the vaccine programme have helped mitigate, to some extent, the impact of the Omicron wave. For instance, our central projection last month was that new infections could reach 50,000 a day by early January. This has not so far materialised. Instead, we estimate that the total number of new infections a day in early January, not just those recorded through positive PCR tests, may have been around 30,000. In other words, it is very likely that the situation we face now, though serious, would have been even more challenging without the renewed sacrifices made by people across the country over these past few weeks. Further, while we need to be cautious in our interpretation of the daily case numbers at this stage, for reasons I'll set out shortly, we can see from these and also from hospital data some early indications that the situation might be starting to improve. Over the past week, an average of just over 12,700 new cases a day were confirmed through PCR tests. However, this is down by 17% compared to the daily average in the preceding 7 days. Indeed, on this measure, cases have fallen in the past week across all age groups except the over 85s. So this is encouraging, and it does give us some hope that cases may be at or close to the peak. However, as I said a moment ago, caution is required in interpreting these figures. The changes to the guidance on testing that I set out last week, to the effect that those without symptoms testing positive with a lateral flow device no longer need to get a confirmatory PCR test, mean that the current daily numbers are capturing fewer positive cases than before. To address this, Public Health Scotland will augment its daily reports in future. I can advise Parliament that from Thursday, in addition to reporting the number of people testing positive for COVID through a PCR test, it will also report a combined figure for the number of people who have recorded a first positive PCR or a lateral flow test. Given the increased complexity, not least the need to avoid duplication, there will initially be a time lag in this reporting. So the data released on Thursday will cover the period up to today. However, Public Health Scotland will be working to reduce this time lag in the coming period. This additional data will allow us to assess the trend in cases more accurately than now. Of course, this is dependent on all of us actually recording our lateral flow results, whether positive or negative. So let me take this opportunity to remind everyone that this can and should be done through the UK Government website, and you can find that page easily by searching for how to report a lateral flow test. There is one further piece of data that gives us some grounds for optimism at this stage. While the number of people in hospital with COVID has continued to increase over the past week, putting significant additional pressure on the NHS, there are signs that the rate of increase may be starting to slow down. The number in hospital with COVID increased from 594 2 weeks ago to 1,147 this time last week, an increase of 553. Since then, it has risen further to 1,479, a smaller increase of 332. It is important to note, however, that the number of people with COVID in intensive care has increased more rapidly in the past week than in previous weeks. However, this is likely to reflect the time lag between people becoming hospitalised and then requiring intensive care. So, in summary, the situation just now is undoubtedly serious, but perhaps less so than it might have been, and there are also some signs that we may be starting to turn a corner. That said, the position is still fragile and significant uncertainties remain. I've already explained the uncertainties in the data, which mean that the picture is not yet quite as clear as we would like it to be and as clear as we hope it will be in the next week or so. And of course, we don't yet know what impact the post-Christmas return to work and school will have on the level of infection. What we do know is that staff absences resulting from high levels of infection are causing disruption in the economy and in critical services, and also that the NHS remains under very severe pressure indeed. Continuing to slow down transmission, therefore, remains a vital imperative. The conclusion of all of this, in my view and in the view of Cabinet, is as follows. It is reasonable and right to be hopeful on the strength of the latest data. However, for the period immediately ahead, it is also prudent to remain careful and cautious. This is the balance of judgment that has informed the decisions Cabinet reached this morning. As I indicated earlier, we will begin to lift the protective measures announced before Christmas from Monday, but we will do that in a phased way that will allow us to form in the days ahead a clearer picture of the trends in infections and the associated impacts. As a quick reminder, the measures I am specifically referring to here are limits on attendances at live public events, the requirement for distancing between groups in public indoor places, and the requirement for table service in hospitality venues serving alcohol on the premises. I expect to confirm further dates next week. However, I can confirm today that the attendance limit of 500 at large-scale outdoor events will be lifted from Monday at 17th January. That means, for example, that spectators will be permitted again at major outdoor sporting events, including football fixtures scheduled for early next week, and the forthcoming Six Nations rugby matches. The COVID certification scheme will remain in place for these and other events and venues previously covered, but with two important changes. Firstly, our guidance will now stipulate that the organisers of large events of 1,000 or more people should check the certification status of at least 50% of attendees rather than the current 20% or at least 1,000 people, whichever figure is highest. And second, from Monday, the requirement to be fully vaccinated for the purposes of COVID certification will include having a booster if the second dose was more than 4 months ago. The NHS Scotland COVID status app for domestic use will be updated from Thursday so that its QR code includes evidence of booster vaccination. It will also be possible to order updated paper and PDF copies of vaccination status, which are now valid for 3 months, and it will still be possible to gain admission to events and venues covered by the certification scheme by providing proof of a recent negative lateral flow test. Presiding Officer, Cabinet will next review the data at our meeting a week today, and I hope this will allow us to lift the other protective measures, limits on indoor live events, table service and hospitality, and distancing in indoor public places from the 24th of January. However, I will confirm this in my statement next week. There is a related point I want to draw to Parliament's attention today. As we do lift these other protective measures, it will be necessary to consider again if extending the scope of COVID certification to other venues might be a necessary protection. To be clear, we have not yet taken any decisions on this, and it will require careful judgment. But I want to be clear to Parliament today that it is something we feel bound to give appropriate consideration to. What I have just set out gives our direction of travel in relation to the additional measures set out before Christmas in response to Omicron. The baseline measures that were in place before the emergence of Omicron, such as the requirement to wear face coverings in indoor public places and to work from home when possible, will remain in place for now. So too, for at least the immediate period ahead, will the advice to the general public to try to limit contact with people in other households, and in particular to limit the number of households in any indoor gathering to a maximum of three. We're not advising or asking people to cut all social interaction. That simply isn't practical and also has a serious impact on mental health and well-being. But trying to limit social interactions remains a sensible step at this stage. It helps stem, to some extent, increases in transmission, and so it has a collective benefit, but it also helps protect us as individuals. At a time when 1 in 20 of us could have the virus, the risk of becoming infected when we mix with others is, at this moment in time, a significant one. So cutting back on contacts where possible and prioritising those that are most important to us helps reduce that risk. And if we make sure that there are no more than three households in any indoor gathering we do have and take lateral flow tests before we go, we further reduce the risks. So all of that remains important for now. There are four further issues I want to touch on today before I conclude. The first is to underline again, as I alluded to earlier, that staff absences caused by the virus are right now having a very significant impact, obviously on the NHS and indeed on the wider economy, but also on other vital public services. And most notably, for the purposes of my comments today, I would refer to social care. We are working very closely with local partners right now to maximise the resources available for social care so that vulnerable people get the care they need. In order to give priority to social care, some local authorities and partners may require to make difficult choices that involve temporarily pausing or reducing other services. These decisions, which will be taken by frontline partners, will only be made when absolutely necessary, and the recent changes, of course, to self-isolation rules will help alleviate some of the pressure. However, where such decisions do prove necessary, I hope members and indeed the wider public will understand that they are driven by the needs of those who depend on social care services. My second point is about ventilation in schools and in early years settings. Before Christmas, we published revised guidance for these settings, which included updated material on ventilation, which, amongst other things, made clear the circumstances in which use of air cleaning devices may be appropriate. To assist local authorities with this, I can confirm today that we will allocate an additional £5 million of capital funding to local authorities and to funded early learning and childcare providers. This, of course, is in addition to the money previously provided for CO2 monitors and will support any remedial work that councils need to do to improve airflow and comply with the new guidance. The third issue I want to cover is the continued importance of vaccination and, in particular, of booster vaccination. The programme, of course, continues to go exceptionally well, and Scotland, as of now, continues to be the most vaccinated part of the UK in terms of first, second, third and booster doses. But there are, right now, still too many eligible people who are not yet fully vaccinated. If you are one of them, and if you have no good reason not to be vaccinated, the reality is you're putting yourself and you're putting others at unnecessary risk. The latest available data, which is adjusted for age, suggests that someone who is not fully vaccinated is at least four times more likely to require hospital treatment than someone who has had a booster or a third dose of vaccine. So whatever age you are, getting boosted is the single most important thing you can do to protect yourself from the worst impacts of COVID, and in doing so, to help reduce pressure on the National Health Service. And even though being fully vaccinated doesn't completely eradicate anyone's risk of getting COVID, it does reduce that risk. And that also then reduces the risk of you, if you get COVID, passing it on to others. It reduces the risk because you're less likely to get COVID of passing it on to others, including those who may be more vulnerable to serious illness. So in short, being fully vaccinated could save your life or it could save the life of someone you love. But the inescapable flip side of that is this. If you are choosing without good reason not to be fully vaccinated, you're putting your own life and the lives of other people at unnecessary risk. So if you haven't been able to get your booster or third jab yet because you've been self-isolating or because you tested positive in the past 28 days, or because you simply haven't got round to it yet, please do come forward now as soon as possible. And if you haven't had a first or a second dose yet, please do so without delay. Don't run the risk of later regretting or indeed of leaving your family to regret that you didn't take the opportunity to get the protection against illness and death that vaccination does offer to all of us. There is right now plenty of capacity in vaccination centres across the country, and you will always be welcomed. So please do go along. It is not too late. It is never too late to be vaccinated against this virus. The final issue, Presiding Officer, I want to touch on briefly today is the work I mentioned last week on a revised strategic framework. This is intended to set out how we might adapt in the medium to longer term to living with this virus in a way that still mitigates the harm it does, but without the kind of restrictive measures that we are all tired of and which we know do harm in other ways. Living with the virus, a phrase that we hear more and more right now, is what we all desperately want to do, but I think it is worth reflecting on what that does and does not mean. Unfortunately, it doesn't mean waking up one morning soon and finding that COVID has disappeared or that we no longer need to think at all about mitigating the harm it can do. Hopefully, we are on a path from COVID being an epidemic to it becoming endemic, in other words, existing at more manageable and consistent levels. But that's not a shift that any government anywhere can just declare or wish into being. And while it seems that the impact of the Omicron variant on individual health is milder than past variants, it is not harmless. It still causes serious illness in some, and it still takes lives. This virus, to be blunt, remains a significant threat to public health. So trying to live with the virus, as we all want to do, will involve, for all countries, careful thought and possibly some difficult choices. And it involves consideration of and empathy for everyone in our society, including those who are at the highest clinical risk from COVID. We know that we cannot continually rely on restrictive measures to manage the virus because we know the harm that does. But equally, we can't be indifferent to the continued risk that COVID poses to health and well-being. So we need to consider what adaptations we can make to manage those risks in a way that is much less disruptive to our lives and, of course, much less of a daily presence in our minds. So these are important issues for not just government, but for all of us to consider. So as we prepare the revised framework in the days to come, we will seek to consult across Parliament and also with business organisations and other partners across society. And our aim is to publish the revised strategic framework within the next few weeks. Presiding Officer, as that final point emphasises, we do remain in a highly challenging phase of the pandemic. Case numbers are high and the impacts of that are severe. And of course, the future trajectory, as I've set out, does remain uncertain at this stage. But largely because of the efforts everyone has made, we are, I think, in a better position than I feared would be the case when additional measures were announced in December. And I do hope we are now seeing signs of improvement. That is allowing us to start the process from Monday of lifting the additional restrictions, and I hope that next week I will be able to confirm the further steps in that process. In the meantime, though, we can all continue to act in a way that keeps things moving in the right direction. So I'll close with a reminder of what we can all do to help stem transmission. Firstly, get fully vaccinated as soon as you can. If you haven't done so already, please do that and do it this week. Second, try to limit your contacts for a further period. With infections at such a high level just now, every interaction comes with a significant risk of catching the virus. So prioritise the contacts that matter most to you. Third, if you are meeting other people socially, test before you go every time. Take the test as close as possible to the time you will be meeting and seeing other people, and remember to record the result, whether that is positive or negative. And take all the other precautions that we know make a difference. If you're meeting indoors, limit the number of households in the group to 3 at most and keep windows open. Work from home whenever possible. And to employers, I would say again, please enable your workers to work from home whenever practical. Wear a face covering on public transport, in shops, when moving about in hospitality. And of course, make sure the face covering fully covers your mouth and nose, and follow all advice on hygiene. These steps do make a difference. They are making a difference to each person's individual safety and also to the collective safety of all of us. So I would urge people to please stick with them, and my thanks again go to everyone who is doing that.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement, and I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The latest data shows that we're in a far more positive position than the government were expecting. The projections in December have not come to pass. We may have already passed the peak of Omicron. And there are two main reasons for this. Firstly, the success of Scotland and the UK's vaccination scheme is clear. People who are vaccinated are much less likely to suffer serious symptoms and are far less likely to be hospitalised. The second main factor is the response from the general public. People across Scotland got their booster, took tests, self-isolated when they needed to. They were cautious to protect their families and especially careful around the vulnerable. That's why the data is more positive. The outlook is much better now, not because of government restrictions, but because of people's good sense. The people of Scotland got this right, not the government. The First Minister says we need to learn to live with COVID. But after 2 years, people across Scotland have already learned to live with COVID. By now, people understand what's necessary to combat the virus. We have to trust their judgment far more as we move forward. We should be looking to get a balance that is much more in favour of wider public health and mental health and physical health concerns, and of course, our economy. And that's why it's so disappointing to see the Scottish Government again looking to extend their vaccine passport scheme. Scottish businesses, Scottish jobs and our economy are set to be hit harder, even though the data is more positive. The SNP Government have accepted there is no evidence that the vaccine passport scheme actually stops or reduces the spread of the virus. So can I ask the First Minister, on just what evidence is she considering expanding the number of venues affected by the scheme and the number of people who will be checked going to stadiums and large events? Which kind of businesses could be impacted by the extension of the scheme and from what date? And does she really believe her plans, which will see more than 30,000 vaccine passports checked at Murrayfield during the Six Nations next month, are actually workable? And finally, while crowd attendance at outdoor events will now be allowed, there's not a single mention in the First Minister's statement about indoor sports events. These are vital for indoor sports events, not a single mention in her statement. These are vital for people's mental and physical health. So will the First Minister lift these restrictions? If so, when? If not, why?
First Minister.
Firstly, we are in a more positive position now than we might have been and that I feared we would be when I spoke to Parliament before Christmas. But there are still significant uncertainties, both in the data and in the circumstances that lie ahead as schools have returned and some people have returned to work. I think that calls for continued caution, coupled with the optimism I think we can rightly feel as a result of the more positive signs in the data. As I said in my statement, I think the progress we have made is down to a combination of the vaccine programme, particularly the booster delivery, the response of the public, but some of the sensible steps that have been taken. It's interesting that Douglas Ross is certain that the measures he likes have been responsible for progress, but the measures he doesn't like, he's equally certain that they have not played any part in the progress. It's not for the first time a rather incredible position to take. I'm also struck by the fact, Presiding Officer, that some of the measures that the public are willingly following, and I thank them again for that, that Douglas Ross is now also rightly praising the public for, face coverings, for example, working from home when possible, are all things that in past weeks and months, Douglas Ross has stood here and absolutely opposed and said the Scottish Government was wrong in asking people to do. We'll continue to take balanced, cautious steps to try to make sure that our progress out of this phase is one way and that we don't end up going backwards despite the unpredictabilities we know are associated with this virus. I did mention on the two specific points, I did mention indoor events. I hope that we will see indoor events which, for the avoidance of doubt, although I think most people listening would probably know this, that includes indoor sporting events, will resume on the 24th of January. But because of the uncertainties ahead, it makes sense to do this in a phased way. And as we have done so many times in the past, when we face things, we lift measures on outdoor events before we do the same for indoor events. And on vaccine certification, as we lift essential protective measures in some settings that we know are higher risk for transmission, despite the best efforts of those who run these settings, we are duty-bound to consider whether there are any other measures that will mitigate and protect against those risks. That's where vaccine certification comes in. I think people, the vast majority of people, accept that if the price of getting to access pubs on a normal basis or nightclubs on a normal basis may be showing you're vaccinated, that may be one that they are willing to pay. We've not taken a decision on extending the scope. We will consider that carefully and we'll come to a balanced judgment. Finally, on Murrayfield, it's not too long ago that Douglas Ross was telling me that Murrayfield would never be able to do the spot checks that we were asking for then. They have been excellent in coping with this and I have every confidence that the SRU will also be able to do that. In some other countries, of course, it's 100% checks of vaccine certificates that are required. So I've got every confidence in the football authorities and in the rugby authorities to continue to operate responsibly and effectively.
I call Anna Sarwar.
Mr. Officer, can I start by sending my condolences to all those that have lost a loved one? There are reasons to be optimistic, but we are right not to be complacent. I welcome the easing of restrictions, particularly on outdoor sports events. Last week, across this Parliament chamber, contributions from multiple members stressed the importance of providing up-to-date and comprehensive data, not just because it is vital for this Parliament to do its job properly in scrutinising the government, but because that information being in the public domain is vital to maintaining and building public trust and confidence. It helps people across Scotland make decisions about what is right for them and their families. The First Minister promised Parliament the data would be available on Friday. Instead, we got, at best, a partial data set. That is not acceptable. The government must have been basing decisions on this information. If not, why not? And if yes, then why not trust the public and share that information? A new phase of the pandemic must mean a new approach, one that recognises we will be living with COVID in some form for years to come. That means building resilience back into the heart of our NHS, but also into our economy, and recognising the toll the past 2 years has taken on the mental health of many Scots. People can no longer live their lives waiting to hear on an ad hoc basis on what the rules will be day by day. Businesses and workers cannot plan for the future properly if they cannot predict the government's response. So I welcome that the First Minister now recognises the need for a proper framework. So can I ask, can she confirm whether this will include clearly set out trigger points for any future restrictions? That could include rates of infection, hospitalisations and staff absences. And will it also include key triggers on what financial support will be available alongside that? Finally, can she commit that Parliament will vote on the framework and that any deviations from that framework will also come to Parliament for consent?
First Minister.
Firstly, the data, the basic data is published every single day. When we can and need to augment that data, that is what has happened. I've set out today the way in which Public Health Scotland later this week will be augmenting that data to take account of the change to testing advice. And on the data around hospitalisation, those in hospital because of COVID versus those in hospital with COVID but for another primary reason, Public Health Scotland published on Friday the preliminary results of the analysis they've been doing. I'm not sure whether Anas Sarwar is somehow suggesting that Public Health Scotland is hiding some data that they have. That is not the case. They are doing careful, detailed work so that that information is robust. What was published on Friday is broadly in line so far with similar findings in England about the split between because of and with COVID. It's broadly in line with, although slightly different, to the same data that was published in August last year, I think, at an earlier stage of the virus. So that data will continue to be updated as Public Health Scotland can robustly and confidently do that. But I would say, as I said last week, any government that was basing all of its decisions right now on that particular data set alone would not be serving the country well, because there is a real limit. It's important information to have, but there's a real limit to the significance of it in terms of the impact of COVID, because somebody who is in hospital with COVID, even if COVID is not their primary reason for admission, it still triggers a response that has a massive impact on the National Health Service, and the fact that they have COVID will potentially exacerbate the other condition that they are in with. So I would caution again oversimplification of the significance of that data. Finally, Presiding Officer, I'm certainly happy to give a commitment that we'll ask Parliament to consider and to vote on the draft revised framework. We will always come to Parliament appropriately with changes to our approach, but I would repeat again, just for the importance of understanding this fact, that the virus doesn't wait until Parliament considers things. It spreads at its own pace. So sometimes governments everywhere have to respond quickly in the interests of public health and public safety. We'll consult on the contents of the framework in terms of triggers that it includes. Yes, we will look to give as much clarity and certainty as possible. But let me say this finally, Presiding Officer, and it goes to the point about predictability. Of course we want to give as much clarity and predictability as possible, but we are dealing with an infectious, unpredictable, mutating virus. Any government that gets itself stuck in fixed triggers or fixed ways of thinking about things is not serving the health and the safety of the country well, and we will not do that.
I call Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I'm very concerned that the use of vaccine certification is set to continue, not least because it doesn't show venues who is sick and who is well. I'm also concerned about their wider rollout to a new array of venues, particularly when many of those venues are pulling themselves off the map from following the latest hospitality curves. I'm also concerned that with just 5 days notice, big sporting events are going to nearly need to treble their checking capacity, leading potentially to bottlenecks and safety concerns that they have already raised with this Parliament. Presiding Officer, the First Minister talks about living with the virus. That is a concept all too familiar to 100,000 Scots who suffer long COVID. That number is surely going to rise with the surge that we currently face. I wonder if the First Minister can tell us that more than 100 days have passed since the government published its long COVID action plan, and yet we are nowhere. Where are the long COVID clinics? Where are the care pathways? Where are the long COVID nurses? So can I ask the First Minister, what is she going to do with those thousands of Scots who have been living with this virus, some of whom since the start, who are still waiting for support from her government?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, on the points that have been raised, firstly on vaccine or COVID certification, Alec Cole-Hamilton and I will have to agree to disagree. I think vaccine certification has a role to play. Let me briefly illustrate it just by reference to any individual. If an individual is in a setting where the risk of transmission is higher and they get the virus there, if they are vaccinated, as I said in my statement, their risk of being hospitalised is significantly lower than it would be if they're not vaccinated. So making sure somebody is vaccinated before they're in that setting has a significant benefit to individuals. But because it then reduces the chance of that individual being in hospital and adding to the pressure of the health service, it has a broader societal benefit as well. So there is a place there, and I believe it's an important place. Of course, we continue to consider it carefully. On the issue of checks, some sports clubs, as I understand it, have already gone beyond the minimum 20% in guidance, but it's not too long ago that members were saying that the 20% was unattainable and undeliverable and would lead to all sorts of chaos. That wasn't the case, and I have confidence in the bigger sports clubs that they will do this effectively, because it is in the interest of sport, of sports clubs, that we keep these settings as safe as possible. The Long COVID Action Plan, Presiding Officer, continues to be implemented. I think, again, it is wrong and an oversimplification to focus purely on one model of long COVID clinics. That has a role to play, but it is the overall pathways of care. It's the development of specialisms, the developing understanding of long COVID and its implications that is encapsulated in that wider plan, and we'll continue to take that forward in partnership with clinicians and health boards across the country.
I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Presiding Officer, through the course of the pandemic, the First Minister has made difficult decisions in complex situations. Recently, we've heard reports that the UK government are considering withdrawing free access to lateral flow testing, with some senior UK ministers advocating even shorter self-isolation periods, and even some influential Tory MPs calling for an end to all restrictions, regardless of infection rates, on the 26th of January. Even in the face of an endemic rather than a pandemic, does the First Minister agree that free lateral flow tests must remain a key part of any protection strategy? And can she also reassure those watching that the gradual lifting of Scottish restrictions will continue to be balanced against wider public health needs?
First Minister.
Well, thanks to Michelle Thompson for that question. On the last part of that question, yes, I do think it's important we get this balance right. We all want to move again back to normality as quickly as possible. We know from past experience, if we do that too quickly or in the wrong order, then it can set us back rather than take us forward. So these judgments continue to be made as carefully as possible. On the issue of lateral flow testing, I think living with COVID is likely to involve for some time the need to test ourselves in particular situations, and therefore for that to be effective, I think it is essential that we continue to make lateral flow tests available as widely as possible and free of charge, and that is a really important principle to the effective working of any testing strategy. The UK government has been at pains to say they are not thinking of removing free access to lateral flow devices anytime soon. I hope we see that assurance solidify and replaced actually with a clear commitment to continue with free lateral flow devices for as long as necessary. On the issue of self-isolation, we, after careful consideration, moved from 10 days to 7 days. Having done that, I think it would be a mistake to go further than that before we've had a chance to assess the impact of the change made. But we'll continue to keep all of these things under review and informed by the best clinical and expert advice possible.
Myrtle Fraser, to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister talked about the protection that vaccination and being boosted provides against serious harm from COVID. Does she agree that publishing the figures for the numbers of those in hospital and in ICU as a result of COVID who are not vaccinated would help reinforce that message to the public? And why is the Scottish Government still not announcing these numbers despite repeated requests from these benches?
First Minister.
Well, Public Health Scotland is providing information on the relative risks of vaccination and non-vaccination. I'm sure Murdo Fraser has seen it in past Public Health Scotland reports. And as I said in my statement, the up-to-date data shows that you are more than four times greater risk of being hospitalised if you are not fully vaccinated than you are if you are fully vaccinated. Public Health Scotland will continue to consider how best to present information, but there is no dubiety and no doubt whatsoever about the fact that if you are fully vaccinated, your risk of serious illness is significantly lower than is the case if you're not fully vaccinated. And that's a message all of us should be giving loudly and clearly.
Jackie Bailey to be followed by Joe Fitzpatrick.
Staff absence in the NHS due to COVID is sitting at 3%, but in social care it's 9%, and care packages have been withdrawn for several weeks now. And acknowledging the crisis in social care, can the First Minister comment on reports that the Scottish Government is considering paying family carers £15 an hour in the absence of care packages being put in place? Can she advise if this is a short-term measure? And can I ask the First Minister, if family carers are to be valued in this way, why won't her government value professional care staff by paying them £15 an hour?
First Minister.
Well, that's not a policy or a proposal from the Scottish Government, so hopefully that deals with that point. We are increasing the wages of social care workers and have taken steps to do that and want to continue to do that as resources allow us to do in order to properly value the contribution that social care workers make. The issue of staff absences is particularly acute in social care, which is why I spoke about the very significant work that the Scottish Government is doing with local authorities and other partners to make sure that we are maximising the resources that are going to support those who rely on social care, and pointing out that even if in the short term that requires local authorities to take resources from other services to make sure those most vulnerable who rely on social care get the services that they need, that is what they will do. So we continue to work very carefully with local authorities to achieve that. But as always, you know, it's very easy to set out the problem, as Jackie Bailey, if I may say so, always does very well. But finding the solutions to this, including indeed the solutions that come from continuing to bear down on infection, are what we must focus on. And as I would agree with Jackie Bailey, that includes increasing the wages of social care workers, which this government is already doing.
Joe Fitzpatrick to be followed by Sandesh Gilhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister will be aware of calls from UK Cabinet Ministers for the self-isolation period to be cut to 5 days, seemingly without sufficient regard to the potential risks involved. Can the First Minister advise what consideration the Scottish Government is giving to this issue, and can she provide an assurance that any changes will be guided by expert clinical advice?
First Minister.
Well, as I said a moment ago in response to Michelle Thompson, we will consider the clinical advice on this issue. We'll keep this issue, as with all issues, under regular review. But having just made the decision to move from 10 days to 7 days, not an insignificant decision, as I said last week, not a decision that comes without risk, I think the prudent and sensible thing to do is to monitor the impact of that before deciding whether or not to go any further. And that's what we'll do in the period ahead. I think it would be a mistake to very quickly move from 7 days to 5 days. But as I have already said, we'll continue to discuss this with clinical advisers.
Sandesh Gulhani to be followed by Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's reported that Scotland's National Clinical Director has said that closing nightclubs and cancelling football fixtures has made little difference to Scotland's coronavirus case numbers. As the First Minister said in her statement, the behavioural response of the general public and the vaccination programme have helped mitigate to some extent the impact of the Omicron wave, but contrary to the statement, it seems these restrictions may not have. When was the First Minister first aware of this data on closing nightclubs and cancelling football fixtures? And will the First Minister commit to providing all the data, not just the basic data, as said in a previous answer, that the Cabinet uses to inform its decision-making ahead of announcements? I mean, why keep it a secret? And for clarity, I wish to point out, in case of confusion, that I am not against proportionate restrictions to mitigate the impact of the pandemic.
First Minister.
Well, I'm certainly glad that the member has been clearer on that point this week than he managed to be last week. Look, the National Clinical Director is possibly the most misquoted person in Scotland at the moment, and I suspect this is the case in relation to the member's question here. It is not the case that there is secret data that we take decisions on, and you know, the member is a doctor and understands more than most the difference between data, evidence and judgment. We publish all of the data that is there and relevant. Data is case numbers, it's numbers of hospitalisations, it's the numbers who sadly die. That's the data we publish. The evidence is where are the risks highest in terms of transmission, and we know that's where ventilation is most difficult, where people come together, where often alcohol is involved. And then we take all of that and we apply our judgment to how best to stem transmission. That's what we do every week. It's what we will continue to do. It is difficult, and I wish it was easier to draw absolute causative links between measure A and outcome B. But all of what we are seeing right now, not just in Scotland, but I would suggest in many other countries as well, is that it's a combination of vaccination, behavioural response, and proportionate balanced measures in higher risk settings that are helping to blunt the edge of this Omicron wave. There's no magic wand to be waved here, but it's that combination that is helping us through, and it's that balanced combination of measures that we'll continue to seek to take.
Eleanor Whittam, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have been contacted by constituents who have advised of their anxieties as they await for cases to go to court. As we know, court closures during the pandemic have led to a significant backlog of cases. Can the First Minister provide an update as to the Scottish Government's work to enable backlogs across the Criminal Justice Service to be cleared?
First Minister.
This is an important area of work, and all of the different justice agencies are focused on doing it. As Eleanor Whittam and other members will recall, the recent budget announcement included significant funding increases for the justice portfolio, which will help reduce the backlog and also support community justice services in recovering from the pandemic. We've also established a Justice Recovery Fund for the next financial year to further help with recovery, renewal and some longer-term transformation activity across the justice system, which will include the ability to maintain enhanced court capacity and remote jury centres, which have been really important in dealing with the situation so far. So, again, there are challenges facing the justice system, as is the case across all aspects of government responsibilities, but investment has been made and action has been taken to get those services back to a normal operating basis as quickly as possible.
Gillian Mackay, to be followed by Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The importance of complying with public health guidance to safeguard the most vulnerable in society and to protect our public services has been paramount for the last 2 years. In that time, so many of us have made sacrifices, not seeing loved ones and not visiting those in crisis. But the level of solidarity shown by the public in following guidance and laws has been impressive. It's therefore absolutely sickening that once again it appears that the Prime Minister and his inner circle have ignored the rules and tried to cover it up. This is undermining public confidence in following health advice. The public feels betrayed and the Prime Minister must go. Does the First Minister agree, and what can we do to retain public confidence in current measures?
Before the First Minister responds very briefly to Ms Mackay's question, can I just emphasise to Ms Mackay that questions must focus on issues of devolved competence? Thank you. First Minister, very briefly.
Public health and the protection of public health is very much a devolved competence, in my view, Presiding Officer. And it is the case that people across the country are aghast at the revelations about Downing Street's conduct. It appears not just one isolated breach, but serial breaches of guidance that people were following through painful sacrifices right throughout this pandemic. And a Prime Minister who apparently is not being truthful about his knowledge of these matters. I don't think it will surprise anybody to hear my view that the Office of Prime Minister would be greatly enhanced by Boris Johnson's departure from it. But more importantly, I think at this moment in time, the interests of the United Kingdom would be enhanced by that as well.
Yeah. I call Pauline McNeill to be followed by Paul McLennan. Excuse me, I'm just going to rewind slightly and call Annabel Ewing. Ms Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I
It is clear, indeed, that from the start of the pandemic, the extent of the buy-in to the COVID restrictions on the part of the people of Scotland, if not, as we have heard, number 10 Downing Street, has in fact been quite remarkable. Can the First Minister, therefore, take the opportunity today to reiterate that the essential rationale for the remaining restrictions is indeed to protect the NHS as we navigate through another very challenging winter?
First Minister.
I think the groans coming from the Conservative benches when this issue is raised suggest that they are really out of touch with the feeling and the sentiment across the country. People over the last 2 years have been unable to see loved ones on their deathbeds, have been unable to go to funerals and comfort other loved ones during bereavement, have had long periods of absence from those nearest and dearest to them. And to find that it appears that those making the rules in Downing Street on a serial basis were breaching those rules is deeply angering people and deeply upsetting people. And that has to be understood and acknowledged. And I understand that anger, but what I would say to people across the country, and this is very much my responsibility, Presiding Officer, as First Minister, with chief responsibility for trying to protect the public health of the country, is notwithstanding anger at politicians, wherever and whoever they are, these rules, this guidance is there for a reason. It is there to try to keep you safe and to keep the country collectively safe. And I would ask people to continue to do the right thing, as the vast majority have been doing throughout. And again, take the opportunity to thank everybody for all of the sacrifices that have very painfully been made.
I call Pauline McNeill to be followed by Paul McLennan.
Thank you. There are many examples of the impact of COVID restrictions on the events industry. For one agency, only 7 Hogmanay shows went ahead out of 60 planned. So the loss of income due to COVID restrictions for many in the sector is catastrophic. I do, however, welcome the additional support the First Minister had announced last week. But can the First Minister make sure that everyone in the events industry chain who needs support, and that would include agencies as well, will be eligible to apply for financial support?
First Minister.
We are working very closely with the sector to do exactly that. I'm not going to stand here and pretend that every single organisation, business, agency that feels, doesn't just feel, that will have had a financial impact will get full compensation for that. But all of the packages of support that we've put in place are designed to try to ensure help goes to those right throughout the supply chain of whatever sector we're talking about. And that very much includes the event sector. So that's the work that we're doing with the sector to try to make sure that that happens.
I call Paul McLennan to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister highlighted progress in regard to the revised strategic framework. Can I ask the First Minister what the consultation process will entail in regard to public health, education, business and local government bodies?
First Minister.
Well, we intend to, as I said in my statement, publish a revised framework as quickly as possible, and I would hope we will do that over the next few weeks. But we also want to consult as widely as possible. Principally, of course, we will consult with members and parties across the chamber, but we will also ensure, and teams in the Scottish Government responsible for these areas will ensure that stakeholders in the economy, in education, across the wider public health community have the opportunity to feed in their views. Living with COVID has become a shorthand phrase. I'm not sure that when I say that, I mean the same things as, for example, Boris Johnson means when he says that, and different people will mean different things by that. And that's not a pejorative statement, that is just a statement of fact. But it's important that we consider carefully what living with COVID means and the different trade-offs that might be involved with enabling us to do that. So that means we need to listen to views from across society and make sure that we take the best possible advice and expertise we can. And that's what we will seek to do, albeit in a relatively short timescale.
Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Don't run the risk of later regretting or of leaving your family to regret that you didn't get the protection against illness and death that vaccination gives you. First Minister, those are your words, not mine. Thousands of vulnerable and at-risk people are stuck in hospital or have been waiting weeks to be discharged and have missed getting a booster jab. How will your government ensure that vulnerable people stuck in Scottish hospitals get the protection that you and I have received and they have missed?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, and I've made this point before because this is actually an important issue, and it's important, I think, that we don't misunderstand the situation. Whether or not somebody who is in hospital gets the vaccination is down to clinical decision and judgment. There is no blanket prohibition on people in hospital being vaccinated, and I think it's important to understand that. But of course, in relation to people who are in hospital when they could be discharged, our focus is on appropriate discharge as quickly as possible, because that is better for the individual, not just because they can be normally vaccinated, but for all sorts of other reasons. But that is also in the interest of the wider National Health Service, because it alleviates some of the pressure that comes from delayed discharge. But let me stress again that whether somebody in hospital is vaccinated or not is not the result of some blanket policy. It is down to clinical decision-making.
Siobhan Brown, to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A concerned constituent has been in touch as his mother is in a care home in Ayr, where the residents have been told they need to self-isolate for 14 days when they're testing positive. With the self-isolation period being reduced from 10 days to 7 days, can the First Minister advise when the guidance for self-isolation in care homes will be updated?
First Minister.
This is obviously an important issue, and I think everybody understands and agrees that protecting those in care homes who are often most vulnerable to COVID is an overriding priority. The measures that are currently in place do enable loved ones to have meaningful contact with residents in care homes while balancing that risk that comes from COVID, and the need to keep people safe in line with public health advice, especially given Omicron, is very much underpinning the decisions we take. Given the changes to isolation that I set out last week, we had already commissioned public health experts to review the guidelines currently in place around self-isolation for care home residents, and we expect to be able to update that position imminently, and I undertake to ensure that Parliament is notified of that as quickly as the work allows us to do.
Pam Duncan-Glancy, to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I heard the First Minister's answer to my colleague Jackie Bailey, but it is my understanding that areas, including Orkney, are already considering policy of paying family carers £15 an hour to discharge people from hospital, and that a government minister has been quoted saying this in the press at the weekend. If this is happening, it appears to be a rushed policy that alone will not resolve the problem, and unpaid carers have yet again not been involved. 90% of unpaid carers have stepped up, providing 24 hours a day support for nothing. 10% who actually do access carers allowance have been doing the same for the equivalent of 35 hours at £1.93 an hour. Unpaid carers are again rightly feeling bruised by a sudden realisation that they're key to the pandemic response, faced with a continued lack of acknowledgement of the solutions that carers organisations have offered the government. So can I ask the government, what are its intentions around this policy? How will it determine who gets £15 an hour, who is left on £1.93 an hour, and who gets nothing an hour? And how can the government ensure that they don't create a three-tier system of unpaid care, where some people are paid at a rate we believe is right for the job, as my colleague Jackie Bailey has set out, and others are left in poverty on £1.93 an hour or nothing at all?
First Minister.
Well, let me be clear again. The government has no plans to introduce a system to start paying family members £15 an hour or any amount an hour to look after elderly relatives. Individual partnerships may adopt different approaches as they see appropriate in their local circumstances, but it is not a Scottish Government policy or position. In terms of the Government's position, we do champion, of course, self-directed support to allow family members to employ people to provide care. That's an option we encourage people to explore where appropriate. We do recognise, I have repeatedly recognised, and we recognise through our policies such as the carer supplement allowance, the enormous contribution made by unpaid carers, and we are actively considering how we can further support unpaid carers who I do think are shouldering a disproportionate share of the COVID burden at this time. And of course, as I said in my statement, we are working with local authorities to help support the social care service more generally through a very difficult period, and that includes not just in the immediate term but in the longer term, increasing the pay rates within the social care sector.
Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Omicron has had a hugely adverse impact on foreign travel, resulting in thousands understandably cancelling holidays over Christmas and beyond, with travel agents spending more time at their own cost in terms of staff and utilities, handing back money to customers rather than booking holidays. Can the First Minister advise what support the Scottish Government will provide to hard-pressed independent travel agents, many of which are family-owned and will struggle for many months to come?
First Minister.
Well, this is a difficult time for travel agents, as it is for businesses in different sectors across the economy, and we're trying as hard as we can to target funding to sectors that are most immediately and most severely impacted by the measures that we have in place. So we've recently announced additional support for businesses, and we are working with different sectors, including in the travel sector, to get that money to affected businesses as quickly as possible. And that work will continue for as long as there is a necessity to have measures like this in place.
Edward Mountain, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, before the COVID pandemic, around 2,000 people were waiting for orthopaedic treatment in NHS Ireland. Now the figure is closer to 2,800, with a projected waiting time for new patients of years. First Minister, with the local national treatment centre not yet built, staff recruitment looking increasingly difficult, what urgent actions can be taken during the pandemic to reduce these high waiting times?
First Minister.
There is action currently being taken in the form of additional investment and efforts to maximise capacity to reduce waiting times as the NHS recovers. We set out, of course, in the NHS recovery plan, the medium to longer term commitments around increased capacity. That includes the commitment to national elective treatment centres. It also involves increased recruitment. Recruitment is a challenge right now in health, social care and across the economy. Of course, one of the significant reasons for that is the implications of Brexit and the ending of free movement, which is something we need to make sure we don't lose sight of. But we will continue to support the National Health Service in a range of different ways to try to avoid unnecessary admissions, to reduce delayed discharge at the other end of the hospital system, and to make sure that we get those waiting times back down as quickly as possible. But crucial to that, of course, is getting COVID under control so that we reduce that pressure on the NHS and enable it to focus fully on the recovery work.
Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What reassurances can the First Minister provide to the pregnant women who may have reservations about getting vaccinated?
First Minister.
I obviously am happy to provide an assurance about the safety and efficacy of the vaccine for pregnant women, but perhaps for any woman who is pregnant, rather than hear that from me, somebody who does not have clinical qualifications, I would point them to midwives, to the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists, the Royal College of Midwifery. All of these expert voices are not just giving assurances about the safety of the vaccine for pregnant women, but actively encouraging pregnant women to get vaccinated. So let me repeat that call. Please, if you are pregnant and aren't yet vaccinated, take steps to do so. It provides you with protection and it provides your unborn baby with protection as well.
And Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the First Minister advise how the Scottish Government is financially supporting people on low incomes who are required to self-isolate?
First Minister.
What we're doing as much as we can to ensure that those who are on low incomes and are being required to self-isolate, which is a very difficult thing to be asked to do, get the support that they need. We have put aside a further £100 million for the self-isolation support grant, for example. That means that those on low incomes who are asked by Test and Protect to self-isolate can apply for the £500 grant, and if they are eligible, that helps ensure that they can self-isolate without financial hardship. We will continue to keep under review all of the different ways that we can help people to do the right thing by self-isolating if that is what they're asked to do.
Thank you. That concludes the First Minister's COVID-19 update. My apologies to those members I was unable to reach. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.